Actresses are not allowed. Only on screen.
That's right.
Hi, I'm Dominic.
Hi, I'm Ludivine.
We're going to be working together.
I was on top of you during the first Gulf War. You remember?
I remember now, during the first Gulf War.
Yeah, exactly.
Yes.
Yes, when, you know,
yeah, when
Iraq
the
got invaded.
Taken,
yeah. George Bush.
You were on top of me?
Yeah.
That's right.
And then we swapped.
I was on top of you after. Yeah, I remember.
It's the beginning of a great romance. You were on top of him twice, on two different hymns. During this movie, no?
I never thought about that. I had two love affairs in this story, yeah.
Is it strange to have to deal with two different men who are the same guy?
Well, no, because, you know, I know Dominic was a bit, you know, it was an issue for him to get the two characters isolated, but to the audience and to the other actors, it was so clearly distinct that, you know, to me, I had the impression that I was facing two different actors. Every time he had these teeth on, I knew that I had to be cheeky. And if he didn't have his cheeks and teeth, I knew I could be myself.
So you could see it as easily as we can see it on
very
camera.
Very easily.
So how were you approached for this, Dominic? I mean, you're not necessarily the first person I think of as
first choice. No. Well, I wasn't approached for it. I found the script and people were already attached to it and different directors had been attached to it, but I'd never read anything like it. And the opportunity that it had for an actor to play those dual roles, I'd never seen anything like. And I just had it at the back of my mind, and I always reminded people I was working with about it and whether it was still happening. And suddenly I got a phone call one day saying that it was the person I think was doing it was no longer doing it, and that Lee Tamahori was meeting people. So I went and learnt a few scenes and sort of decided how I thought this person should be and how the other guy should be, and we were very much on the same page in terms of our way of thinking about these people and how it was important not to make an accurate biopic of what we thought these people to be. And actually it was about a development of these characters, and then I that's how I got into it, and then I got the role. So
intimidating at all? I mean, this really is not, we think of you dancing and singing on the streets of Greece.
Yeah. Well, you know, I think it's important to just continually do very, very different things at either end of the spectrum. I think that's why we do what we do. And I think it's people seem to want to pigeonhole you and put you in categories. We as humans just like to do it. It's a comfort thing or something. It's just so we want to understand who people are and know them. And it's important for us to continually fight against that, I think.
And be always where people don't expect you to be.
Well, you've been doing this since you were a child, practically.
Yes, true.
So have you ever felt that, or because you do seem chameleon-like?
Well, I've always been fighting in order to get my freedom as an actress, and that's why I really intend to choose very different roles and genres of films. So to me, playing in a historical action, Lita Mahori's film was a big achievement.
So harder to do the accent as an Iraqi or harder to do it in English for you?
I don't know. I just made it up with the help of a dialect coach. And He was a very demanding coach, but no, the whole thing was challenging. You know, being Sarab, whose main weapon is sexiness, in order to fight the male hostility, that was very challenging because she's not, you know, she's behaving out of fear all the time, and she has to pretend something that she's not, and you realize that throughout the movie. When she encounters Latif, suddenly her weapons fall down, and she happens to be a very normal and sweet person.
You're both kind of doing the same thing, really.
Yeah, true, and that's why they fall in love together, because they're both trapped in the system.
So is it harder to do Latif, or is it harder to do Uday for you?
It was kind of, it was exhausting doing Uday, because he was running on a million miles an hour, and his thought process, you never know what's going to affect him or what's going to spark him off. It was very, very tiring, but exhilarating, you know, to work like that. And Lee's energy that he brought into the room was equally as enthralling. And that helped. But Latif being much more stoic and much kind of more of an observer and more solid and more still. Neither was more difficult than the other. It was just a case of what I found fascinating was that how very small things can completely manipulate and change how you feel as a person. That it was very much to do with the vocality and physicality of either one of them, and just the simple process of putting those prosthetic teeth into my mouth. It changed my entire kind of which she loved very much.
Love kissing prosthetic teeth, or you love just looking at them, or?
No, I loved it because it changed him so completely, and I don't know.
Well, it changes the middle of his face completely.
Yes,
the whole mouth comes
out.
Yeah,
cheeks and teeth, yeah. It made you so
I've
sexy.
I've kept them. They always work on a night out.
So Dominic's not sexy now, but with his teeth in, he's really sexy?
That's what's being said, yes. That is what's being said right now.
No, but it's another, perspective.
Is it different playing against, acting opposite the energy of Uday versus the kind of calm of Latif?
No, well, Sarab acts differently regarding both of the characters,
right.
and I actually handle on Dominic's energy in order to react. I just had to react to the man who was opposite to me. So, no, it wasn't difficult, but with Uday, Sarab is always pretending something. She's never herself.
Right.
And with Latif, she's sincere and she can let it go a little.
So what was jumping into this with Lee like in particular? He's not necessarily the first person you think of for this picture either.
I think that was something that gave certainly me a massive amount of confidence. We as actors, we're not in charge of the style of a piece or how a director envisages something and how they want to portray. We are there to be manipulated and molded into their story. And actually, I wouldn't have felt as secure and safe in many, many other directors' hands with him. And he understands the violent nature of these people, the tribal nature of these people, and the gangster-esque nature of these people. And actually, he was just completely inspiring to work with. We had such difficult... The technology that we were dealing with was new, and the people weren't that sure how to deal with it in terms of doubling up and the memory of the camera. The situation was forever changing and evolving, and he had to think on his feet constantly. He was going a million miles an hour, and it made for that is actually at the heart of this film, I think, his energy.
And also what's great about him is that he's experienced so many different scales of how to make movies. He's been doing major studio movies,
right.
So he knows how to deal with that kind of technical issues and all that. But at the same time, he's very close to intimate dramas. So he's always very close to the actor, even though he has to deal with a thousand other stuff. He's always behind us. And that was great working with him for that.
Did you guys get much rehearsal for this?
We did, actually.
Yeah,
we were often found in some awful CD, no window, lightless room at the bottom of a rock in Malta, sort of going mental for far too long. In fact, I was done with rehearsals. Normally I ask for so many rehearsals, but he really put time aside with everything that he was also dealing with. He really put time aside for us to kind of
to feel comfortable,
and to kind of go through, pull everything apart and really get under the skin of it. We really had an opportunity to do that.
Did you rehearse a script, or did you improvise, or did you
improvised lots, actually, kind of around a very solid script. It's an amazing script. It's a very sparse script, which I love about his writing. It's straight to the point. It's not flowery.
No.
It's like steel. It's just the bare minimum of writing, which is the bare, and it actually gave opportunity to kind of play around and manipulate a little bit. And he wasn't precious either. Michael Thomas not precious about his very visceral. It's just kind of, I don't know, I never quite know how to explain it, but it's very like him as a man, his writing, actually. It's bare and it's but
raw.
Brilliant. It's raw, yeah.
Raw.
Raw.
Not raw. Raw.
Raw.
Okay.
Wrong country. So is there a time when you're on this and you're starting to do this work, and it's a complicated piece where it feels like, okay, now we're in the groove, we know where we are, it's going the right way?
did it ever feel like we were getting it right and it was going well?
Like you were, okay.
There was never
really
a moment where we were just like, yeah, this is all working, because there was always something. And we were filming it on quite a new digital camera, which we called it a red moment, because the camera just decided it didn't want to work for an hour. Right. And that would happen. Then the technicality of the camera was basically on a rail, and it had a memory, and on the head it remembered the exact move. Now that frame had to be identical each time it was filmed, because then I'd step in as the other character and the frame would have to be the same. That was for it constantly going wrong throughout. So there was never a moment of smoothness and relaxation. But I think that...
Did you have to deal with this? With this camera and all these moves? Or?
Yeah.
Yes, because, you know, I would do the scenes twice, once with Uday, once with Latif. So I felt the tediousness of it, but I wasn't properly involved. But, you know, I was supporting my colleague. Mm.
Is that critical on a film like this, that you guys kind of become a tight little crew?
Unbelievably so. Yeah, we got on really well immediately, and we understand Lee as a person. We all kind of saw each other on the same level. We get on really well.
Yeah, we got really close, the three of us.
Yeah. Mm. And yes, it's terribly important when you're doing something like this, because you can get fractious and you can get annoyed and irritated, and people are tired, and it's a small film. And you're not being pampered.
And you have actors from all these different nationalities kind of coming together,
making it more interesting. Really,
does that make it more fun? Is that?
Oh, I think.
Yeah, because it enriches the whole movie. You know, everybody has a personal point of view regarding if he's from the Middle East or of Britain or New Zealand. I think it was a plus, something very positive to it. Definitely.
So, was there a lot of political discussion around the movie on the set, or?
Yeah, we always, I think, the subject matter, it was impossible not to. We didn't want the film necessarily to reflect that. It wasn't, you know, it was a story that we were telling.
We were more focused on the drama and on the characters rather than on the story itself, on the history, sorry.
So was there research? Did you guys see movies like Gunner Palace or anything that really House told Uday's story?
House of Saddam, yeah, of course, it was important to watch all that stuff, and to have an understanding of the history, and it's a history that has affected all of us. It feels so far removed from us, but we were so involved in it, you know, and we were responsible for the relationship with that part of the world, but we know very, very little about it. And that made me feel a bit, I felt guilty about that, and my eyes were opened doing this. I working with people who were actually from that part of the world, it was intriguing, and you were constantly learning, and that's always a good thing.
And he made us personally committed to this part of the world now, because it's very easy not to care anymore. We're so used to hear bad stuff, bad news about it, and we suddenly don't care. But with this movie, I really found myself really frankly overwhelmed by this situation, and I will never look at Iraq the same now.
Mm. Well, the French were not as willing to go as we were.
Yeah,
certainly.
But you know, there is some things before that.
Yeah.
You know, they're not completely innocent.
It's a long history.
Yeah, they sold a lot of weapons, you know.
So is this the biggest machine of a movie that you've been on?
Of a movie, what bit of?
But just in terms of a lot of equipment, a lot of complications, and I mean, Ludivine's films have mostly all been in French.
Yes, but I remember having shot a movie in Australia, Peter Pan, with PJ Hogan.
Oh yes, that was certainly.
That was quite huge.
A massive thing.
Yeah, massive special effects and all that, as I was Tinkerbell, so I was reduced. So I'm quite used to that.
And is it, for you, is it a completely different thing, or is it fun to go back and forth?
It's great to go back and forth, you know, something
that's freedom.
Yeah, it's an incredible, it's a totally different environment in which to work, and it brings out different things in your performance, really. But you have to be tested in, you know, what I said, we did no more than three takes on this film of a scene sometimes. That was it. Huh. Doing something like Captain America, we could be doing a scene for a week with the most incredible, you know, lighting and cameras, and it's a different way of working. That's a discipline in itself to maintain enthusiasm and focus when you're doing the same line for a week.
In front of a green screen?
In front of a green screen. They're all different disciplines to have.
Have you taken time to think about your career as a career at this point? Or are you? Is there a feeling like this is something, another step for you? Or?
Yeah, I don't know. It's nice to know that people will see something that I can do that's different from, you know, the as you said, prancing around in a all-in-one Lycra outfit dancing to ABBA on a rock. You know, that's a different...
Of course, we've only known you for a few years. I mean, ironically, Ludivine's career is like twice as long as yours.
Yeah.
She's a little younger,
yeah, yeah.
But you're relatively new to us.
Yeah. I know, I don't know.
Not for long, though.
No.
I hope to just, I've been lucky enough just to do a very bunch of stuff, I suppose. And I've done a lot of plays as well. But I started doing plays really more than films, so.
Well, History Boys is really kind of the breakout.
Yeah, I was fortunate enough to work with Alan Bennett, one of my first jobs ever. He's one of the most incredible writers who raised the bar with everything that I then looked at in terms of film scripts, because his writing was, you know, it changed and transformed. Every time we performed that on stage, you found new ideas and new... his writing was so multi-layered, and it raised the bar in terms of everything else seemed a little bit subdued after that. So, but it was a wonderful thing to have as a first experience.
So as actors, do you guys look for things that push you, that you think maybe you can't do?
Of course. I'm always looking forward to being in front of a mountain and having to climb it. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, it's not worth doing it if it's so easy, you know? Mm-hmm. Difficulty is the main attraction, don't you think?
Absolutely. It's very easy to... We always are, I think, extremely grateful for being offered work. It's an amazing thing to even... you remember clearly the first day that you actually... Having trained, you know, you train for years and years and years, and the first day you get paid to do something that you enjoy, you're overwhelmed. You go, am I actually... Is this actually work? So even now, up till now, when you're still offered things, you want to say, yes, of course I'll do it. Absolutely, you're mm-hmm. just offering me this. But you have to be so specific and careful with... and challenged, because the moment you do something for the wrong reason and you're uninspired, you will not do something you're pleased with, and it will be worthless.
So how do you choose? Do you choose, I mean, more for Ludivine in this case, I think, because your career is here, whereas yours has been mostly in France. I mean, do you choose by director? Do you choose by the character?
No, I'd say, I would say that in France, I'm kind of a director's collectioner. Can I say
you
that?
You collect directors?
Yes. I like this. It's like a hunting...
hunting directors down.
You put their heads on your wall one
yes,
by one?
Yes, exactly. I'm hunting them. No, but because, you know, I've been attracted to cinema through French cinema with strong... directors who had very strong personalities, mm-hmm. so that's the way I got into cinema. So the encounter with the director is the main reason for why I'm going to do a movie.
Mm-hmm. So on a picture like this, was it meeting with Lee more important than just reading the script?
Well, Lee Tamahori, to me, he's one of, he wasn't on my list because, you know, Once Were Warriors is one of the best movie I've ever seen. So, you know, it was a honor to meet him and to work for him, obviously.
So had you guys seen the film before Sundance?
No, not me. It was the first time.
I had. I had a very small screening in London and it wasn't completely finished.
Did you watch it here? On the
yeah,
night?
Yeah, I watched it on the big premiere night.
So what was the experience like for you guys?
Yeah,
it was so violent. I had to hold your hand all the way through.
It was odd seeing it. I mean, it's a very scary environment. There's such an intellectual film crowd there. They know their films more than anyone. Mm. You know, the mix of the public here and the filmmakers. Mm. You are really it's a scary platform to be part and to be in there. And you have no manipulation or control over it like you do when you're on stage and you're in that environment with an audience there. You're very sensitive towards them, but you can kind of mould and manipulate them or change what you're doing to have the correct effect. It's out of our hands. It was out of our hands the day after you cut on that scene, and it becomes the director's film, really. And you're sitting there amongst them, watching you being ridiculous on screen and completely, you know, ultimately you're just seeing you being, it's impossible to break the barriers of.
So you never feel like you see the movie fully when you're in it?
No, never. I think it's very, very hard to.
Yeah, we never really feel at ease.
You pick. Are you picking on your performance, or are you picking on your nose, or, you know, I don't like that thing on my forehead, or?
No, that would be vanity, and I think you can go beyond that. It's about you ultimately want absolute truth, and you want people to believe that person you're portraying. It's very difficult.
Yeah, and suddenly being part of the story, you have the feeling that you're the only one who's not into it, you know.
Yeah. It's a very odd situation. I think the more and more you see it, maybe it becomes easier. Mm-hmm. The one, you know.
Can you see how Ludivine's doing when you're watching her work?
Yeah.
That's all.
I can watch Ludivine.
Objective about that.
I can watch Dominic with big pleasure, and I don't judge him at all. I'm just at the movies.
So how do you do?
He did a great job, you know.
And so you were a little nervous going into it, I'd say, it sounds like.
And yeah, it's a huge theatre. I think it probably seats over 1,000.
Yeah.
And you're suddenly thrown up on stage without anything to say, because you haven't rehearsed anything. Right. It's not a play again. With your director, with these people that could feel anything, who have good, solid, strong opinions, and they hate it. It's terrifying.
So it was pretty clear, though, by the end, they did not hate it.
Yeah, thank goodness.
So what does that feel like? Is it the applause, or did you have a sense during the movie that the audience was with it? And
you do get a sense, don't you? It felt like people were focused.
Yeah.
It felt like people were absorbed, intrigued, and focused by what was unfolding.
And shocked.
And
at
shocked,
the end.
Yeah.
Mm. And laughing.
And laughing.
And, yeah, there was a funny change, actually, from that moment of not when no one knows what a film is or how it's going to unfold. Mm-hmm. They were seeing the comedy of it, actually, at first, because it's ludicrous. He's a ludicrous man. So, and then suddenly there was I don't know at which point, but it suddenly became so kind of the full horror of the man's capabilities, I think, probably.
When you watch the video of tortures, I think suddenly the audience realize in what kind of story it's been trapped.
Well, I kept on kind of flashing on Scarface and De Niro's Capone and The Untouchables, and actually Little Miss Rain, because there's some of that in there as well.
Yeah, it's a gangster film. It's a country ruled by people without limits.
But he's very funny. I mean, he is a funny guy.
Yeah, well, he's just a madman. He's no one has the capabilities or capacity to control him. He does what he pleases. He has no moral code, and he's been influenced as a young man, as a boy, by a terrifying dictator who probably exposed him to some of the most horrific images any of us would ever see, and for a four-year-old boy to see that, and he has a problem. The mother is treated appallingly. There's so many levels of so many terrible things that are all part of his makeup, and he doesn't know how to behave as a human. So he is a ludicrous cartoon gangster.
So are you conscious of playing comedy when he's particularly in that first act, or are you just playing?
No, never playing. Playing, I think, someone that has no awareness of how ludicrous they are. I think that's where the comedy is, and he's so full of himself, and suddenly has this plaything, this toy, that he can manipulate and change to who he wants to be. He just has no concept of how stupid his clothes even summarise how stupid he is. You know, he's the audacious, disgusting, glitzy, you know, but he thinks he's so cool.
Hawaiian shirts. Mm.
Which he thinks are brilliant. And you know, anyone with any modicum of taste would,
you know. Well, you have to play that too. Your costumes were quite exciting in this movie. Quite special.
But they weren't ludicrous. They were actually quite stunning, I thought. You know, and I think the costume designer made a great job on that film, because it's really real, you know.
Yeah.
All my clothes were vintage clothes from the 80s, and that was actually very realistic, yeah.
There was something very kind of Bob Mackie about it at a cocktail party, and you're looking, you know, got things hanging and all that stuff going on.
Mm-hmm.
Well, she also had to continually inspire Uday, Uday's tastes.
Right.
She was forever changing.
Yeah, so she's always, she's always,
wig on all the time.
Yeah, she got wigs on, she got... She's very
the
tacky clothes, yeah.
He doesn't get rid of. She's the only person that he doesn't just dismiss, kill, maim, or throw in a river.
Because she knows how to play the game and how to entice him all the time in a different way in order to save herself. from a horrible torture, I guess.
Well, you almost get the sense that Uday thinks he's disposable a little bit also, given his father's proclivities. I mean, the audience, I think, we're wondering at times whether or not Saddam is going to say, okay, enough of this.
I think he probably wanted that. He was terrified to. He was terrified at the prospect of him taking over. Because he didn't have the capabilities to certainly to run a country, or even to be a military man.
Yeah.
He was completely out of control. Then they're the most volatile and scary. I think.
So when you get up at the stage at the end, they're applauding wildly and standing on their feet and screaming. Do you feel, okay, now we're done, we got it, it worked, we're there? Or are you still waiting to feel that?
You never feel that, I don't think, do you?
No, you never feel completely satisfied. And the movie just got premiered 2 days ago, so the life of it is still very long. There's a long way to go, there's other festival. Mm-hmm. We will be in Berlin soon. There are many other audience to please, so work hasn't been finished yet.
But it is a wonderful moment, you know, after all that work, to have people suddenly see it and appreciate it.
Yeah,
you
it's
do
a bit
have
of a relief.
Moment.
Yeah.
It's a relief, and it's and I think you should have a kind of, I suppose, a second to think. Yeah, we did work. We all worked extremely hard. Lee worked extremely hard, and it took years to get that film made, as many, many, many independent films do, and everyone should be appreciated for putting that much effort and time and energy into something which they love.
Do you guys carry your characters with you emotionally as you go through this ongoing relationship with this film, or do you, once you're off the stage, do you let it go and move on to the next thing?
There's always something that stays inside of you. You know, personally, to me, Sarab, even though she evolves in a very exceptional environment, she made me understand how all women from the Middle East are secret survivors and how they have to deal with men. Mm. And that's something that I will never forget, definitely.
Mm. I mean, yeah, you do. You're looking through that person's eyes, you're inhabiting them for a certain amount of time. There's always, whether you do a play for a long period of time or you're involved in a film and you're doing a character for a long period of time, there's a certain part of you that changes a bit, your behaviour changes a bit, your attitude, the way that, because it's influenced slightly by how that person perceives the world and looks at things. And it was an extremely scary experience doing it with him. But there was something a little bit more bolshy about me when we went to restaurants that kind of, I was had a slightly bit more attitude, expected to be treated in a certain way. You know, it's too much ice in it, or you know, this cup I can't drink out of that. There's an S, and you just have to keep a check on it. But it happened when you take on your roles with it. It was like when I did the History Boys as a play for 3 years. We all kind of took on our characters and behaved a little bit like that. But then you just have to kind of flush it out.
Do you still have reunions? You guys
run into
each other?
Yeah, I still good friends with all of them. Yeah,
yeah, a very small world. Well, I remember being at Sundance and seeing Eight Women all those years ago, and all the male journalists were happy that it turned out you were an adult, because somehow even as a little girl they were lusting after you, and all these years later nothing's changed a lot.
Thank
but you've changed. Your career has changed. I mean, you've really become. You've gone to a next place.
I'm growing up, slowly but surely.
And is it still as exciting as it used to be?
More and more.
More and more?
Yeah, of course, because throughout the experiences, you get more and more accurate and more curious about what you want to do, and you get more and more tools, and the sensibility is sharpened. So, no, I'm enjoying it very much.
Are you getting offers from the U.S., from Hollywood, that are better and better as you...
Yeah, but you know, I'm not necessarily aiming Hollywood, because there are so many American multi-talented actresses of my age. So I'm just aiming freedom and independence. And in a certain way, I'm doing it quite well, yeah.
And you're aiming for freedom and independence as well, I'm guessing.
Always.
And fun.
I'm a big fan. Yeah, no, it's exactly that. The more independence and freedom that you have, the more creative you can be, and the more inspired you are, I think, because that's ultimately it. Because there's nothing worse than being involved in something that you don't want to be feel passionate or involved in. It's just it's a pointless task. And the more you have control over that, the better.